committee to Mark 2. I'm going to read verses 1 through 5 for scripture this morning. The story about Jesus heals the paralytic. I'm reading from an NIV version. A few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. So many gathered that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he preached the word to them. Some men came, bringing to him a paralytic, carried by four of them, since they could not get in to see Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus. And after digging through it, they lowered the mat the paralyzed man was lying on. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." God, that is blessing to the reading of his word this morning.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
It's been a challenging week and a half for the Schachter family. We were at Karen's dad's place where she fell and sprained and dislocated her elbow. She gets to wear a cast for 3 weeks. Then she gets to have a month of physical therapy. So we're not sure which one will be worse. And then I have 2 stents put in Friday morning, so I'm good to go. With the ever-ready battery. So open your Bibles, please, to the book of Mark, chapter 2, verse 1. In the time of Jesus, Capernaum was a warm and beautiful city. It was filled with palm trees and olive trees. And the streams from the cliffs of the Sea of Galilee watered the orchards, the vineyards, the green fields, and the beautiful flowers. People would come from all parts of the world, from Damascus to Jerusalem, from Mediterranean areas. They would pass through Capernaum. There were farms, there were fishing, all kinds of goods. It was a vibrant city full of life. And Jesus often stayed there in his visits. In fact, Capernaum became his new home. Peter, Andrew, James, and John are from Capernaum. And it was here in Capernaum that Jesus healed Peter's mother-in-law. And there in Capernaum, he called some of the men who would be his disciples. Now, that's the good news. The sad news is that Capernaum, Chorazin, and Bethsaida, in chapter 11 of Mark, receive a strong rebuke from Jesus. It seems these places loved to see Jesus perform miracles, but they didn't have much faith in him. They didn't become followers of him. In fact, all 3 cities were destroyed. Capernaum was laid in waste for centuries. Now turn with me to verse 2 of chapter 2 of the book of Mark. And immediately, many gathered together so that there was no longer room to receive them, not even near the door, and he preached the word. So despite the Sanhedrin's counsel and warning to stay away from Jesus, when Jesus came to Capernaum, the people just could not stay away. They wanted to see and hear this miracle worker. And so they flocked to this house. Many scholars believe it's probably Peter's house. And he preached the word to them. Now, you can't do this if you're in an iPad or an iPhone, but if you have the paper word, if you're one of those people who likes to mark your Bibles, and I would circle that word, logos. It's the word. But to the first century readers of Mark's gospel, that word was synonymous with the gospel. Jesus is preaching the glad tidings, the good news. The time is fulfilled. Verse 3, then they came to him, bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. Your daughter.
Yeah, thank you.
Made it safely. That's pretty hard. Glad you made it safely. So five times in this passage, we're told that this man was sick with palsy, from which we get the word paralytic. It means to be loosed on one side. It indicates some kind of malfunction of the brain motor system or the spinal cord. So what it really means is he was a cripple. And he was dependent on others for transportation. Now, to be physically paralyzed is terrible. But there's something even worse, and that is to be spiritually paralyzed. Mm-hmm. Think about it. This man probably had a sharp mind, may have worked for a good company, but he was a moral cripple. Because he allowed sin to control his life. So it doesn't surprise us that the Bible tells us that all mankind are spiritual cripples. In Romans 5 verse 8, a little paraphrased version here, says, when we were without strength, when we were crippled, in due season, Jesus died for us. Now, let's look at some of the people who make up this story. Let's start off first with the most obvious, those four friends. They were friends of this paralyzed person. They took a deep interest in him. And I love this story because it's really a story about evangelism. It's a story of four men who are concerned about this paralytic. It's a story of four men bringing a friend to Jesus Christ. And that's what evangelism is, isn't it? Bringing people to Jesus. And what we learn from this story is evangelism is not something that's limited only to professionals.
Amen.
Aren't you glad for that?
Amen.
Everybody can do evangelism. Didn't get an amen on that one. And we can learn from the principles of these men's lives. Now, I found this quote. Somebody nicknamed these four men, and they gave them these names: sympathy, cooperation, originality, and persistence. And those are the qualities we need to be a good evangelist. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
It isn't how much you know, it's how much you care. And if we're to overcome the hindrances or the obstacles of sharing our faith, then we need to be sympathetic, cooperative, original, and persistent. Now, the first thing I like about these four men is that they cared. These four men knew that their friend needed Jesus. And they knew that Jesus could heal them. Four friends who said, if I could just, we could just get them to Jesus, he'll be healed. Now think about this question and ponder it. If you got in trouble in the middle of the night, what four friends would you call to your rescue? See, these four friends knew that unless their friend had an encounter with Jesus Christ, that there would be no hope. I wonder if we're that passionate about Jesus, that we'll do whatever it takes to help our friends, our family, know about Jesus? Or do we see our faith as sort of optional, take it or leave it, lifestyle? These four friends believed that their friend needed Jesus. And like the lepers, this paralytic had lost all hope. Because he knew that his disease was a direct result of his lifestyle. And besides a life burdened with pain and discomfort, his life was also filled with deep regrets. He'd gone to the priest and to the doctors, and they told him that he was incurable and that he was cursed of God. That's a pretty bad answer, isn't it? You'll never be well, and God doesn't like you. Because the Pharisees regarded disease as a sign of God's displeasure towards you. Notice verse 4. And when they could not come near him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where he was. And so they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying. Now my next question is going to take interaction. And because you like to whisper, I'm going to have you talk to each other. My wife tells me I'm hard of hearing. So, anyways, if you were in that house, that'd be pretty neat, wouldn't it be, to be in that house, see everything opening up? How would you have reacted? Would you have been annoyed, amused, angry, or sympathetic? So turn to the person to your left or to the right and say, if I had been there, I would have been annoyed, amused, angry, or sympathetic. Okay, don't be afraid of the person next to you. How would you react to him if you were in that house? And you saw this dust and dirt coming down, and you saw the sky open up in the house, and you how would you have reacted? Would you have been annoyed? Would you have been amused? Would you have been angry? Or would you have been sympathetic? Okay. The second thing these men did that I liked, so did you share with each other? Or were you afraid to talk?
I'm in awe.
Pardon?
I'm in awe.
In awe. Yes. Yes. Someone probably said, who's going to pay for that roof? Is that right? Someone probably said it. Might have been Peter or his mother-in-law. These men didn't just sit home and pray. Now in the southeast corner of North Dakota, there's a little town called Wahpeton. It's on the border of North Dakota and Minnesota. 1995 was a 500-year flood. Now the Red River, which runs along that parallel of the Dakotas and Minnesota, all the way to Canada, is one of the few rivers that runs north instead of south. So if Wahpeton floods and Breckenridge, which is the Minnesota side, if they flood, Canada's going to flood. And it was a 500-year flood. So what did that mean? It was destructive. It had rained all week. Friday night, the Red River crested. So when the Adventists came to church Sabbath morning, they had their Sabbath school and they had worship. When church was over, some of the members said, we need to go and help our neighbors. But some said, it's Sabbath. So they said, you stay and pray. We will go and be the feet for Jesus. And they did. These four friends put feet on their prayers. They realized that real faith results in action. Because the palsy man was totally helpless. He had no sense of hope. He was in great despair. But through his friends, he had heard about the wonderful works of Jesus Christ. He was told that others, just as sinful as he and just as sick as he is, had been healed. And to emphasize it, they said even lepers had been cleansed. Now, no one had seen a leper cleansed in 400 years. And so the friends started telling their palsy friend, there is hope. But he became discouraged again when he said, you know, how is Jesus going to forgive me? This is my fault. I'm sick because of my actions. And he feared that Jesus would be like the priests and would not tolerate his presence. But his friends kept talking about the love of Jesus, and he began to think, if he could just see Jesus, just receive the assurance of forgiveness, he'd be happy. He wouldn't need to be healed. He would just be happy that he was at peace. And his friends were determined to get him to Jesus. In verse 2, remember that they ran into a problem. It says, when they could not come near him because of the crowd. They could not find any way in. Nobody wanted to give room because they wanted to be close to Jesus. Now in Eastern culture, they have what is called the open house policy. So when a celebrity comes, all the family and friends come to visit, all the neighbors come to visit, and soon the house is packed. And with this house where Jesus was at was not just packed, it was overflowing, it was teeming with people. Probably the fire department would have had an issue with that. And it caused a problem because this man's he's being carried by four men on a stretcher. Requires a lot of room to get through to navigate, and no one was willing to move or give space. And too often, the people who are closest to Jesus are the biggest problems. Isn't that kind of an odd statement? Sometimes we allow our preferences, our prejudice, or our traditions to become a hindrance for people to meet Jesus. Verse 4 gives a solution. When they were not able to bring him in because of the crowd, they removed the roof above Jesus. Then, after tearing it out, they lowered the stretcher the paralytic was laying on. When there's no easy solution, God gives us other ideas. Now, roofs in Palestine in the times of Jesus were flat, and people often used the roof as a place to go up and sun or to meditate. And so often there were stairs on the outside of the house leading up to the roof. So the four friends decided to go outside and go up the stairs. And then they started digging on the roof. But the roofs were usually made of timbers that were laid across the flat part of the house. Then the timbers were covered with branches. And the branches were covered with clay tiles. And the clay tiles were covered with mud placed over the top, worked in until it was solid and rainproof. Remember those men in that house? Hearing all that noise, all that racket up there, wondering what in the world is going on? And while Jesus was preaching, suddenly he looked up. He saw dust, straw, and dirt. And then he saw sunlight. And then he saw four smiling faces peering through the hole. And then he sees this paralytic coming down. Doesn't tell us where they got the rope from. Verse 5. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son." Now in the Greek, it literally means child. And there are numerous times when Jesus refers to his disciples as children. It's a very affectionate term. He said, "Son, your sins are forgiven." That's why he wanted it. Jesus must have smiled when he saw the enthusiasm of these four men and the paralytic. And he greets them with that expression, "Son, your sins are forgiven." And these words were like music to the paralytic. His depression and his despair just melted away. Romans 5:1, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
We have peace with God. And Psalms 85, verse 8, I will listen to what God the Lord says, for he will make peace with his people, his faithful followers. We have a God who's faithful in providing peace to us. His pain was gone. The most important thing for him was he was forgiven. Now, somewhere in New York, there is a cemetery. There are many cemeteries in New York, obviously. But this particular cemetery, there's one headstone that only has one word on it. Anybody want to guess what the word is? Forgiveness. You're sharp. There are no dates, no birth dates, no death dates. There's no artwork. There's no epitaph. There's just that one word. And what is that word? Forgiveness. It is the greatest thing that can be said to any man or woman. You are forgiven. Jesus dealt with this man's greatest need. His greatest need wasn't new legs. His greatest need was a new heart and a right spirit. And that's what Jesus gave him. I found this quote that says, forgiveness is the greatest miracle that Jesus ever performs. It meets the greatest needs, it costs the greatest price, it brings the greatest blessings and the most lasting results. His faith was rewarded. And you can imagine that laid down, that man's laying on the floor, and he's just smiling. From ear to ear, he's smiling. Because he got the greatest gift he could possibly get. He was forgiven. Yes. When Jesus saw this man's pleading eyes, he knew what he needed. And he knew what he wanted. And he said, son, your sins are forgiven. I made a hospital visit. I've made many hospital visits. But this one was a lady who I had met on a variety of times. She was not a religious person. She was not a church-going person. And she often used the Lord's name, but not the way you and I would want her to use it. But her daughter told me that she was dying. And I went to visit her. And I knew she was on a deathbed. So I started talking to her about God's love for her and how it would break his heart if she went to a Christless grave. And she began to do a litany of reasons why God could not forgive her. And with each one, I remind her that God loves her unconditionally. She finally began to realize that God does love her. And she went to sleep in Jesus. Sin is sin, isn't it? Contaminates us, it destroys us, and we're all infected by it, but we have this wonderful gift of God's grace. The third thing I like about these four men is they work together as a team. Now Mark is the only one of the four Gospels who tells us that there were four men, and they all had to pull in the same directions. Because especially when they go up the stairs, the one thing the paralytic did not want to hear from them was, oops. That's the one word didn't want to hear. Unity is so important for us as Christians. And as a church, we need to pull together. We need to pray for each other, to uplift each other, to encourage each other, and to support each other. The fourth thing is, these men were imaginative. They didn't get up when they saw the crowds. They used their imagination. They did not do just the usual and stood outside and waited. But they were willing to think outside the box. It was not business as usual for them. They began to think, how can we solve this problem? These four friends looked at their paralytic friend and said, we have a problem. And we have a solution. My friends, we need to be solution people, not problem people. Verse 6, and some of the scribes were sitting there and reasoning in their hearts. Now, the scribes were educated men. After the Babylonian captivity, these became the leaders of the Jewish nation. Remember, Ezra was a scribe. Their task, or one main task, was copying scriptures. They were the professional interpreters of the Mosaic Law, and they administered both its religious and its civil codes. The scribes determined what was right or wrong. They were considered the authorities of historical and doctrinal matters. They were the national teachers, and they were surrounded by their own disciples. And they're just sitting there fuming because of what Jesus had just said, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Verse 7, why does this man speak blasphemies like this? Who can forgive sins but God alone? Are you courageous? Are you brave? You're not? You are. Good. Who would like to share that in this story, who do you identify with? The paralytic? The friend? Or the scribes? Speak up for my hard of hearing. The paralytic. And why is that? Pardon?
I'm a sinner. Whatever's wrong with me is due to my own choices.
Okay, good. You bet. I am.
We're lost. We can't do anything of our own. We rely on God.
Now, I suspect there are times when we better identify with the scribes. We just don't want to admit it. Isn't that right? And there are many of you here who identify with the friends. How can I share Jesus? And all of us should be identified with the paralytic. Because we are all sinners, standing in the need of prayer. Verse 8, but immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they reasoned thus within themselves, he said to them, what do you reason these things in your heart? Verse 9, which is easier to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, arise, take up your bed and walk? That you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. Now, the scribes had that doctrine that no sick person would ever be healed unless they were first forgiven. It's kind of a catch-22, because if you're sick, God doesn't like you. And if God doesn't like you, he's not going to forgive you. That's a sad religion, isn't it? It's a religion that sees God as walking with a big stick, looking who he can pound on. Yet our God is compassionate. He is committed to our forgiveness. So Jesus says, I'll prove to you that not only do I have the power to forgive sins, I have the power to heal. And that by healing, you will know who I am. Now they should have been, that should have been a revival broken out, shouldn't it?
Yeah.
But those scribes just could not acknowledge that Jesus was the Messiah. That he was God in flesh. They just could not bring themselves to do that. They were so convinced in false theories that they could not bring themselves to see the Son of God standing right in front of them, forgiving and healing this man, yet failing to recognize who he was. The Jews knew that the Messiah could forgive, but in their narrow thinking, if any man said that he had the power to forgive sins, he was blaspheming, and the penalty for blaspheming is death. And by his words, they recognized that Jesus was claiming to be equal with God, claiming to be God. And those words must have shocked him. And what's important to notice is Jesus doesn't say, my bad. What I meant to say was, the Father forgives them. He says, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Literally what he's saying is, "Son, I forgive your sins. I have the authority to forgive your sins because I am God." Now, Mark includes this exchange between Jesus and the religious leaders so that his readers can know that not only is Jesus the